Japan finally launches the world's smallest orbital rocket and SpaceX booster swims, this and more, now on KNews. Hey guys, Lucas here, welcome to KNews for week 5 2018, and as always a big shout out to you my KNews boosters, who support me creating these videos on Patreon. Thanks for your trust! Now I know this is not the most recent news as this video comes out, but I really want to feature every single week this year, so I'm still catching up on my backlog. First up was a SpaceX Falcon 9 that launched from Cape Canaveral. It went east following a 26 degrees inclined geosynchronous transfer orbit. And that usually means there was a communication satellite on board, and indeed, it was GovSat-1, built by Orbital ATK for Luxembourg. Once in its final orbit, it will hover at 21.5 degrees east over Africa and will be able to reach Europe, the Atlantic Ocean, Africa, the Indian Ocean and parts of Asia with its steerable dish antennas. It has many purposes ranging from civilian to military applications. An example would be emergency satellite calls from ships in distress out in the ocean. To my surprise, Falcon 9 launched with landing legs and grid fins attached, although it would not attempt to land on its drone ship nor at the landing zone. The result was actually pretty funny, but more on that in just a sec. Up top, the booster was as always the upper stage carrying the payload protected by two fairings, which SpaceX is still trying to recover. The launch proceeded as expected. Falcon went up and then received a kick to the side to perform a turn towards its desired inclination. Roughly 2 minutes and 30 seconds into flight, the booster tanks are almost empty and it gets staged away to set the upper stage free, which goes on with the main mission. The fairings separate shortly after and at least one of them is used to test SpaceX's new recovery system. It basically re-enters back into the atmosphere, stabilized by cold gas thrusters, which simply release pressurized gas in little puffs. Once below a certain speed, the parachute gets released, which is still a big problem for SpaceX. According to Elon Musk himself, the main issue is the fairing size. It causes so much turbulences in the air that it is hard to operate a parachute above it. The goal is then to catch it with Mr. Stevens, a ship that is waiting in the ocean. It looks like parachuting things down in a controlled fashion is not as easy as it seems. Meanwhile, the booster also re-entered back into the atmosphere and while there is no drone ship waiting for it to come home, it still performed a landing burn. This one is however special since SpaceX wants to get more efficient at it, so they now fire 3 engines continuously for landing. They previously fired 3 too, but 2 of them shut down just before touchdown. It worked out well, much better than SpaceX actually thought. The booster sunk into the water, tipped over gently, staying intact. Yep, it did not explode as it used to. This is because it is highly pressurized to its limits and falling over means the pressure exceeds what the booster is designed to. So my personal speculation is the booster sunk vertically into the water to then bounce back sideways, or it had a really lucky wave that dampened its impact. Elon Musk joked about pulling it all the way back to the coast, but the sad truth is it was destroyed. The booster malfunctioned and did not release its pressure correctly and was therefore a hazard. Not knowing what was going to happen, B-1032 was attacked and destroyed, I assume as part of a spontaneous training maneuver. However, the details are unclear and I'm not quite sure why they didn't simply send the termination signal. The booster is packed with explosives, just in case something goes wrong at liftoff, but I don't know how much control SpaceX has about that when it's landing. Anyways, back at the upper stage, it has accelerated the payload up to the correct speed to release GovSat-1, which will go on with its mission to circularize its orbit on its own. Next up, now in quick succession, were a Soyuz for Russia, which launched off of their new Vostochny launch site on February 1st. Its destination was a low Earth sun synchronous orbit. And Long March to D for China, which launched from their northern launch site in Jiuquan. That already indicates a similar destination, which was also a sun-synchronous orbit. Up top Soyuz were 5 satellites, the 2 main Russian of type Kanopus-V and several nano-satellites. Most notably, at least for me, are 4 of type SNET from Germany. These are the best satellites, totally unbiased. But wait a second, SNET, what does that remind me of? I forgot, wasn't too important I guess. These satellites are supposed to test a nanosat swarm. Instead of having a few rather complicated large ones that can maneuver themselves around to sit in specific spots, this swarm would just float around randomly in an orbital plane to form a dense network, sort of like a brain. Instead of talking to one satellite of the constellation, you would essentially talk to the constellation as a whole, just pointing your dish upwards into the sky. Terrifying. I mean, terrific. We could, for example, use it to control autonomous drones and such, since they hadn't to bother pointing their antenna in the right direction, just up. The simplicity of each satellite would also make it much easier to produce them with a high degree of automation, without many humans involved, thus cheaper. That sounds like a really good idea if you ask me. But enough trolling. SNET will not take over the world just yet, since this is only a test and is of course not designed to do that. Involved into the mission were also many students of the Tech University in Berlin, Germany. Launching on top Long March 2D is the main scientific payload CSES or China Seismo Electromagnetic Satellite and of course several nanosatellites. CSES is a collaboration between China and Italy, which will gather data about Earth's proximity, most notably the ionosphere and magnetosphere, which interact with the sun's radiation. This research will help to better understand how events like solar flares and solar wind in general impact our planet. And the last rocket to launch that week happened on February 3rd in Uchinoura, Japan. The world's smallest orbital launch vehicle, SS-520, took off into an elliptic low to medium Earth orbit, inclined by 31 degrees as part of a demonstration mission. Up top was another small nanosatellite called Tricom-1R, with a mass of round about 3 kilograms. It's just a test and it's not equipped with many instruments but cameras to take some nice pictures. The launcher is a sounding rocket, where sounding comes from sond or probe. It typically shoots a 100 to 150 kg payload on a suborbital trajectory to take measurements and perform experiments. However, instead of a heavier payload, it carried a third stage, which can boost tiny payloads up to orbital speeds. The rocket is less than 10 meters tall and has a mass of 2.6 metric tons. That's like a beetle pulling a small trailer. The only way to get such a small rocket into orbit is thrust, a lot of it, especially on the first two stages. Every second thrusting upwards counts because Earth's gravity pulls at it. The less time it takes the rocket to release all of its energy, the less time it spends fighting gravity and losing speed. That's quite difficult to achieve even in KSP and my launcher weighs 3 times as much. That's because KSP's parts are made out of lead or something to compensate for the smaller planet. It would be just too easy to get to orbit otherwise. Anyways, the spin-stabilized rocket reaches space and orbit really fast, where it releases its payload. While the first and second stages drop into the ocean, the third will stay in space like the payload, but the orbit will decay over time as it dips quite deep into the atmospheric remains at 150 kilometers. Okay, that shall conclude this week's episode, and I hope to see you next one if you like. Auf Wiedersehen and thank you for watching.